fix on their performance is over the term, in the sense that there are many more explanations that you can think of. But even there are some arguments which are more relevant than others. And some of these, which is very important in terms of the discussion in Mexico, is that they can be addressed without major, by major reforms, I mean not non-constitutional reforms. Because if you think about constitutional reforms in Mexico, like changing the labor law, for example, which is something that's been discussed for a long time in Mexico, means that you need 2/3 of the votes in Congress. And you will never get that. Not soon, because in Mexico, the situation is very polarized right now. There's a lot of political polarization. But instead, you can go on trying to make some small reforms, which are basically the responsibility of the executive, so they can be done. And we discussed some of these reforms in this paper that I mentioned before with Hernández Trillo. And we discussed some specific reforms that can be done to give more power, for example, to the Antitrust Commission in Mexico, to reform the rule, some aspects of the rule of law, all these regulations of the financial sector can be done without any constitutional reforms and so on. So that's why I think instead of getting into this discussion of reforms like the labor or energy reforms, which actually have been promoted by the government in recent years and have led nowhere because they get quickly politicized and polarized, we should start discussing how to make this change like the ones we discussed in this other paper and in this book that I'm working now. So that's what we need. And in that sense, as I said before, if we don't do any of these changes that I mentioned before, we don't change the fiscal, we don't make a fiscal reform, which actually is also necessary, and get resources for the government to spend more in, for example, better education, increase the supply of high schools, for example, across the country, or to change the private sector just to get enough resources for better place for the students to go to high school or to university and so on and so forth. If we don't any of that, why should Mexico be rich? So I think as long as we don't discuss the most relevant aspects of that, and we are like stuck discussing things that actually divide Mexicans by ideology or for other reasons, politics, whatever, we are discussing these things which to me are really relevant. The most relevant things are the ones I mentioned before, and all of that can be addressed without major constitutional reforms. So instead of discussing things that actually divide Mexicans, if we discuss the things which are relevant, but we need to identify them first, which is what I'm trying to do in this paper, I think then we can take the next step, which is making reforms possible. And that could help Mexico to get out of this period of stagnation in which we are right now, instead of discussing these things which are actually more controversial, like labor reform. As I said, unions in Mexico are never going to accept a reduction in their labor rights, and these are very strong groups in Mexico. So that's why I conclude with this, and that's why the title of my talk is "Why Should It Be?" We don't do any of these things that we should be doing right now.
Clarify something with your last slide, the conclusion, talking about two different labor reforms, like in the third bullet, you said that avoid some unnecessary reforms, like the labor or energy reform, that could be politicized, that's fine. But then in the other bullet, you said in order for social and labor reform are also needed. Are you talking about two different types of...
Well, I'm talking about something different. I didn't talk a little bit about, I cut a lot of discussion here, but this is, at some point I also discussed the fiscal reform. Mm-hmm. Fiscal reform is also very important because many of the things that you could argue about, I mean, what's needed, in spending from the government. Mm-hmm. So Mexico has the lowest tax burden in Latin America, basically. The only country that has a similar lower tax burden used to be Guatemala, and now Mexico is the one with the lowest, which is like 8% of GDP. Just to give you an idea, in Brazil is like 30% of GDP. So they collect a lot of taxes. Mexico doesn't collect taxes. Mexico actually leaves from very small amount of taxes, and then from oil revenues. So, so the government is very small in Mexico, relatively small, and cannot spend, for example, investing on infrastructure, which is something else I discussed in the paper. Infrastructure cannot invest on education. I mean, expanding like the supply of high school or university or things like that cannot be done from the public sector perspective because they doesn't have resources. So here, there's another discussion about what do we need in terms of fiscal reform. And what I argue here is that we need something that guarantees vertical and horizontal equity, which means that horizontal equity means that everybody that earns a wage or an income, if it's the same level of income, should pay the same rate. That doesn't happen in Mexico. In Mexico, there are some sectors, for example, I have to pay taxes. I mean, there's no way I can avoid it. But there are some sectors in Mexico which for law are exempted. So people can earn twice as much as I do. Or people, rich people, for example, get a lot of their resources from capital gains, and they don't pay taxes at all. In the US here, you pay a smaller tax rate than the income tax rate, but it's like 15%. In Mexico, you don't pay any. So rich people actually can get around and do not pay any taxes. People in some sectors, like agricultural sector, for example, they don't pay any taxes. They are exempt from paying taxes. So that's why we need a fiscal reform. Now, but what I said is that fiscal reform, just to collect more taxes, it's going to be blocked very easily, which is what has happened in the past. So we need to do something like more comprehensive, saying, I'm going to do this tax reform, but I'm going to give you all these other things in return. For example, that's why it's called the social and labor reform. So we need, for example, we don't have in Mexico unemployment insurance. So the unions can say, well, okay, I can accept changes in the law, and I can accept that you take some rights from that I had already won in the past. But if you give me, for example, an unemployment insurance, which we don't have right now in Mexico, or the social reform, which means that you need to have, for example, health insurance. Well, we don't have health insurance. If you get unemployed, you don't get any health insurance in Mexico. So you need to offer something in return to the increase in tax collection. And you have to, the government needs to commit itself to say, I'm going to raise taxes, but I'm going to do this with your money. Because so far the government in Mexico has collected more income, for example, from the recent oil boom, which has actually expanded with no, has been actually dilapidated the revenues from the oil boom. And that's because there's nothing in place in which the government can commit itself to do, if I get all these extra revenues, I'm going to do this with this one. So that's why and some of the parts of the paper, of the book, where I'm discussing this thing about why do we need a more comprehensive approach. So we need a fiscal reform to get more money from the government. The government needs to commit itself to spend it in a better way than has done it so far.
With regard to spending tax revenue, can you comment on the concentration of that? How centralized are you? What is being invested in, and how much does it cover sort of the country as a whole? Or?
Basically, most of the Mexico's public finances have some problems. On the one hand, on the revenue side, Mexico depends a lot on oil revenue. So, like in an average year, like 1/3 of total revenues come from oil. More or less. In oil years, like the ones we have had in the past, that goes like 40%. So it's a lot of money from this revenue. Now, on the expenditure side, most of that goes through, Mexico has this, any government has, can spend money in current expenses or investments, capital expenses, which is like investment, like infrastructure. So most of the resources go to the current expense, which only means that when you have extra money, then you start hiring more people, or paying more to the workers and so on, and to the bureaucracy, and therefore, and like 90% of total expenses go to current expenses from the government. And that's why I think the government needs to make a commitment to say, if I get more resources, I'm going to spend them here. Since, because so far what the government has been doing only is additional resources, is actually increasing the size of the government in terms of bureaucracy, or in terms of social transfer, which are fine. I'm not against social transfer, that is very important. But social transfer alone, as I showed you before, even though have increased substantially in the past few years, are not enough as to get people out of poverty. So you need to commit to do something else with that, with those reasons. And to me, I think the most important thing, and this time I didn't talk a lot about that, but this is investing on infrastructure. I mean, part of the reason why Mexico probably is not going that fast in recent years, because the government stopped doing what it used to do. The government in Mexico used to invest a lot in which is called public goods, like building infrastructure, ports, airports, highways, and providing electricity and so on and so forth. And that attracted more private investment in those areas. And since the government stopped doing that, so there's no public investment, there's no private investment following, and I think that's part of the problem. So we need to invest much more resources in the public. But in order to do that, the government needs to change, but the government doesn't have any incentive to change, unless it is is being done in the context of a more comprehensive reform. And that's why I always discuss that, not here, but in the book, larger version. Okay. But this is like the other part which I didn't actually address here, which is very important, the role of the government. So I just discuss here things which are like a smaller reform, particularly focusing on the private sector, the financial sector, and the labor market. But we can discuss a lot about it, what the fiscal sector is, what the government can do. Because whenever you start discussing this, when I start discussing this about, for example, human capital building, you might have a discussion about what's the best way to do it. I mean, do we want to do it with public institutions, in which case we need to invest resources there, or do you want to do it with private sector, in which case you need to generate the market for that, because there's no market for that. I mean, there's not like in the US, where you can borrow money to go to the US. Those things do not exist. So you need to generate either the public investment or the private investment, or both simultaneously, but you need to do a lot of things in order to create those conditions to promote this investment, this market and incentives for people to invest in the place.
Yeah, what you were saying about Mexico and the oil boom reminded me of what I was just reading about Chavez and the oil boom. In a way, that I heard the similar critiques about what he's done with social transfers and increasing the size of the government. So it seems kind of strange that the Calderón government would be guilty of the same kind of squandering as you were saying. Is that true? Is there also the element of clientelism?
Well, in some sense it is. I mean, but it's not just Calderón. It was started actually with President Fox.
Right.
And it's quite important. I mean, the resources they got were very substantial. They were much higher than any fiscal reform that had been proposed before. So they got all these extra resources. But since that is not regulated, since that is like a windfall. So when they do the budgeting process, they say, okay, we're expecting these resources. If the price goes up, then this is a windfall. So what do with that? It's very discretionary. So there's no rules on that. And that's why I think you also need a rule there. And actually, I have another paper where I discuss what rule should that be. But then what the government does is precisely do what any government would do, not just Chavez, just any government, which is, if I have resources, which I have no restrictions to spend on, and I want to be like more political support, but I can just give more transfer. And that's expecting probably to get more political support. That's what the government is doing. And that's probably what Chavez did in Venezuela, but this is also what the Panistas government in Mexico are doing. Because it's rational, I mean, at least self-interested thing to do. Mm-hmm. But probably it's not the best thing to do in terms of the long-term perspective.
Yeah, I have a question about have you presented this? Is there like a work group that the U.S. and Mexico that are discussing these things? Because I think that what I see that is really disconcerting is that with these trends, the way things are discussed here about migration, about other things, they're like like they're missing the point.
Yeah, well, I agree completely. I mean, but I discussed it with many people. The problem with that, with this kind of discussion, is the government is not open, unfortunately, to this discussion. I mean, the government believes that you go and discuss with them. I have many friends there in the government, because when I studied my PhD, I had the, many of my classmates are now in the government at very high levels. But they are actually, if you ask, talk to them, they live in a different world. I mean, their perspective is completely different. Mexico doing well, it's no problem. We are doing the best thing we can do. We have been facing difficult circumstances, but we are doing all this. And but from a long-term perspective, which is more than what I'm trying to do, I think the results are not that good. I participate in many groups, in many discussions, in many arenas, and so on. And that's part of the division in Mexico, of the polarization that I was talking about. On the one hand, there's a group like the ones in which I belong and I participate in, which are very critical of what the government is doing, with the good arguments, I think, based on data and all that, not just ideology. And we are not participating in this, we are not from a political party perspective. But on the other hand, the government, which is very close to this discussion, and the government believes that everything is going well. And that's quite unfortunate. And that's why I think, and that's why they are proposing things like the labor reform, which I think is going nowhere. Or the fiscal reform without commitment on spending, social reform, which again is going nowhere. So all these reforms, I mean, and then you find all this, I skip that at some point, but one of the arguments that has been pointed out is as explanation for this situation in Mexico, is the political situation. Because what they say is everything gets stuck in Congress. And I don't think that's the reason. I think that's that only reflects what's happening in the population, which is we are very divided about where Mexico should go, what change should be done. So that's not the cause again. That's probably a consequence, this division of Mexico. And but yeah, there is a actually I would say there is no debate about this within the Mexican or with the Mexican government. Yeah. There's some discussion within the society and so on, but not with the Mexican government. The Mexican government is like completely isolated from this. And you see what they say, you see the report, I mean, Mexico is doing fine, Mexico is doing well, and they are doing, they are recovering from the crisis and all that. This is, they live in a different world. I talked to many of them, many foreign seminars, foreigners and all that, and completely have different view in terms of what's important, what's not.
It's from the group of students that invited you. The committee or what is it?
Yeah, it's a society in politics.
Thank you for listening. Okay. We complementary to this talk.
Yeah.
You will never get that. Not soon, because in Mexico, the situation is very polarized right now. There's a lot of political polarization. But instead, you can go on trying to make some small reforms which are basically the responsibility of the executive, so they can be done. And we discussed some of these reforms in this paper that I mentioned before with Hernán Estrillo. And we discussed some specific reforms that can be done to give more power, for example, to the Antitrust Commission in Mexico, to reform the rule, some aspects of the rule of law. Mexico's underperformance is overdetermined, in the sense that there are many more explanations that you can think of. But even there are some arguments which are more relevant than others. And some of these, which is very important in terms of the discussion in Mexico, is that they can be addressed without major, by major reforms, I mean not non-constitutional reforms. Because if you think about constitutional reforms in Mexico, like changing the labor law, for example, which is something that's been discussed for a long time in Mexico, means that you need 2/3 of the votes in Congress. So that's what we need. And in that sense, as I said before, if we don't do any of these changes that I mentioned before, we don't change the fiscal, we don't make a fiscal reform, which actually is also necessary, and get resources for the government to spend more in, for example, better education, increase the supply of high schools, for example, across the country, or to change the private sector just to get enough resources for better grades for the students to go to high school or the university, and so on and so forth. If we don't any of that, why should Mexico be rich? So I think if, as long as we don't discuss the most relevant aspects of that, and we are like stuck discussing things that actually divide Mexicans by ideology or for other reasons, politics, whatever, we are discussing these things which to me are really relevant. The most relevant things are the ones I mentioned before, and all of that can be addressed without major constitutional reforms. So instead of discussing things that actually divide Mexicans, all these regulations of the financial sector can be done without any constitutional reforms and so on. So that's why I think instead of getting into this discussion of reforms, like the labor or energy reforms, which actually have been promoted by the government in recent years, and have led nowhere because they get quickly politicized and polarized. We should start discussing how to make these changes, like the ones we discussed in this other paper and in this book that I'm working on now. And,